Mr. Achyut Kulkarni. He is a leader for applied and unitary stream for India and SAARC market at Trane Technologies. He is responsible for driving applied and unitary business growth for Trane Technologies HVAC vertical. Since 2013, he has worked in functions such as pre-sales and large projects within the organization. He is mechanical engineer and LEED AAP from USGBC. He also participate in forums like ISHRAE, Ozone Cell, and represented Trane in roundtable discussions organized by related to HFC phase downs and HCFC phase out schedules. Today, Mr. Kulkarni will talk us through innovative HVAC technologies to achieve energy efficiency for built environment. So, delegates, let's welcome Mr. Kulkarni.
So, just a quick key facts about the corporate overview. Where do I work? A company history, Trane incorporated in 1913. We have one more vertical called Thermo King, which was founded in 1938. Headquartered in Swords Island. We are already listed in NYSE, and the stock ticker is TT. In terms of the global footprint, on the manufacturing, distribution, and office locations in US, we have close to 434 facilities. EMEA is around 141 facilities. APAC is around 132 facilities. We have thousands of engineers working worldwide in labs, factories, software, design hubs, and so on. Global strength is close to 37,000 plus employees for Trane Technologies. Very interesting, very close to heart, the mission statement what we have, boldly challenge what's possible for a sustainable world. Okay, I think we all heard a lot about the trends, technologies with respect to energy and environment. I think this EE is very, very important in today's scenario. It's not just the energy that needs to be focused on, but also the environment. We had excellent information given to us with reference to the refrigerants. We had good information passed on with reference to the energy levels in terms of recooling and so on and so forth. I think it is, all in all, I believe very strongly that both energy and environment are two key factors that's actually driving the sustainable environment. Quickly, I would just like to go through this ICAP, which is India Cooling Action Plan. One best thing and the most important fact is that India is the first country in the world to develop such a document. It is freely available on the Ozone Cell website. You can just type ICAP on Google and you will be able to download the copy. Very interesting document. You can have good insights about the ongoing trends in HVAC, ongoing challenges in HVAC, and how India plans to overcome those challenges. Very well documented, very well, very, very informative, and it's very good to read. Three out of five goals that emerges from this ICAP document are the reduction in cooling demand across all sectors by 20 to 25% by 2037-38, reduction in cooling energy requirements by 25 to 40% by year 2037-38, and reduce the refrigerant demand. So the total, there are around five goals. Out of five, three goals clearly emphasizes on the cooling demand, cooling energy, and the refrigerant demand. The focus is very clear, as Sandeep just mentioned, that we need to follow certain guidelines which are already published, the NBC codes, ECBC code, PEE codes, which are already published and which are readily available, which will definitely help us to achieve these goals as stated in the cooling action plan. This is the trajectory plan, what we have. If you look at the growth in terms of the sector-wise growth in the cooling demand, it is enormous. From 57% what we saw in 2017-18, that's expected to grow to 74%. And that is only with respect to space cooling in buildings. Likewise, you can see for the refrigeration, transport, cold chain, etc. Okay, I just want to brief something very interesting, again, which is very, very close to our heart. Trane Technologies has taken a huge leap in terms of both energy and environment, like what we discussed. We have something called as the Gigaton Challenge, and definitely it's what it takes to make a huge difference. I think it's definitely going to make a huge difference. What is that plans we have? we have planned to reduce 61% of the greenhouse gas with reference to the refrigerant footprints. We all heard about the refrigerants in terms of the GWP, ODP, half-life and so forth. So 61% reduction is the target what we have. 24% increase in the energy efficiency in 2019 compared to a 2013 baseline. We have already achieved it. We are designing a lot of good energy efficient products that are hitting the market. 50% reduction in greenhouse gas emissions intensity in our operation since 2013 baseline. So we have remapped our facilities, we have remapped our factories, and thereby we plan to reduce 50% of our greenhouse gas emissions within our operations. Fortunately, we are in a good company. A lot of other companies are also picking up. These are some of the names which I have mentioned here, but we have seen a lot of HVAC industries also participating to it. We have a lot of control companies like Siemens and all. They also have come out with this. A lot of companies are marching towards this good initiative and making sure that they have the they reduce the carbon footprint. Now, just to brief what is done so far and what has happened so far, we are able to reduce close to 7.7 metric tons of carbon equivalent compared to a 2019 baseline in 2020. So the task what we had in front of us, we have already halfway through. We are already on plan, and we are sure that we are going to achieve these numbers much, much ahead of the deadline what has been set forth. One important message, our erstwhile chairman, Mr. Mike Lamarck, if you just go through it, our actions are predicted on a strong belief that one company can change an industry and one industry can change the world. And it's really happening. Okay, just to go straight on the topic of the energy efficiency, the main factor we discussed on the TCO, we also heard about TCO, the total cost of ownership, sometime back. It's not just the lowest bid. The ownership is not the first investment what we do. It's much beyond that. Today, if you look at it, 10% of the life cycle cost is on the design and build, and 90% of the life cost goes to operate and maintaining those equipments or the buildings what we are into. And one thing, return on investments, that is ROI, is not on the lowest first cost always. Okay, search for the efficiency. If you look at the focus, it's not just the chiller alone or the cooling towers alone, it's the complete plant. It's not the, like typically we see that we select the most efficient chiller but forget to select the right equipment, like it could be pumps, cooling towers, piping, design, all that. So high performance chiller is definitely not an high performance chiller plant. Okay, some of the recommended design strategies for an high pressure, high performance chiller plant: use super high efficiency chillers, pump, cooling towers. We have an ASHRAE benchmark, we have ASHRAE green dyed benchmarks, we have a lot of BEE benchmarks, we have a lot of guides are available where they mention about the minimum efficiency requirements that have been listed. But definitely we have much more efficient products that are available in the market. We need not have to just meet, but also try to stretch more than what is available, do better than ASHRAE 90.1 requirements. Low flow, low pressure, chilled water and condenser water system. Plan to go for a large delta T systems. When we say the large delta T, even the ASHRAE 90.1 2016 guideline says that no need to design a chiller for 10 degree delta T. You can extend it up to 15, thereby reducing the pipe size, the pump size, the pressure drops and so on and so forth. Just try to work on those lines. Try to get more and more feedbacks available from these particular guidelines and try to implement them. Variable primary chilled water flow systems, typically the VPF systems, which is now become very popular, but still we have some systems which are still running on the primary and secondary system. I think better to switch on to this new one, which is the variable primary flow. Definitely we'll be able to save 20 to 25% of the power. Cooling tower optimization, most important. We select the right pump, we select the best efficient chiller, and if you don't select the right cooling tower, then it becomes a problem because the efficiency of the chiller again depends upon the cooling tower. Add VSD and try to get if you can extend the heat recovery capacity of the cooling tower. I mean, if you can size a little larger cooling tower, then the requirement will definitely yield good benefits in terms of the power consumption of the chiller. Configuration, very, very important. No need to go for a standard configuration. You try and mix and match depending upon your load pattern, depending upon your applications. try and mix to see whether you can have a combination of VSDs, non-VSDs, a screw and centrifugal. So a lot of options are available, a lot of informations are available with each and every chiller manufacturer. Try and get the configuration done, pros and cons, and then assign the right one for your building, for your needs. Most important, extensive continuous high precision monitoring, which is very, very important. We need to have the control systems in place, automation in place. That will definitely help us in order to measure the current efficiency level and the benchmarks, what is being set, whether we are on the benchmark or we are not on the benchmark. That's very important to understand. So good design, smart operation definitely will lead us to a sustainable performance.